Hello, everybody. My name is Connor. It hasn't been that long since I made a video, but I'm returning to a series that I haven't touched in a long time, from pixels to pictures. This is actually my fifth video in this series, and it's a series that wasn't necessarily popular, but I wanted to return to it just for myself, mainly. I really like doing these videos, and it gives me something to think about, which we should probably address that. So right now we are going through a transformative time in history. This is the sort of thing where if you're young, you will one day be telling your grandchildren about this. And there's no denying that it's scary, but right now the best thing we can do is just stay inside, and stay hopeful and also stay distracted. So I'm trying out a whole bunch of things, getting back into these videos for one, but also online groups, chatting, organizing stuff with online groups, playing video games, listening to podcasts, watching my favorite movies over and over, sleeping in late, maybe even indulging in a couple of vices I probably shouldn't be indulging in. But you know what? Treat every day like it's a self-care day. We will get through this, and when it's all over, we'll have a lot of great stories to tell. So, with all that being said, let's talk about some video game movies, shall we? In 1995, Mortal Kombat was released. It was the fourth video game movie ever made, according to my list, and it was also by far the most successful one to date, both in terms of reviews and box office. And naturally, when a movie is very successful, Hollywood looks to see if they can make a sequel. And seeing how the first film ended on a cliffhanger, and because the game they had adapted was the Kickstarter of a successful franchise, it seemed inevitable that a sequel would be made. The first film's director, Paul W.S. Anderson, decided not to return for this film, opting instead to make Event Horizon. Stepping into the director's chair this time around is John R. Leonetti, who was the cinematographer of the first film. However, most of the cast from the first film also declined to return after reading the script, which was probably the right move. This movie's box office performance was abysmal, and the critical response? Fatality. This is not a good movie, and you would be hard-pressed to find anyone who would disagree with that statement. But how did it perform as an adaptation? Now, sequels to video game movies can occasionally muddy the waters in terms of what exactly they are adapting. Even though this movie is technically Mortal Kombat 2, it is not an adaptation of the game Mortal Kombat 2. The plot was actually inspired by Mortal Kombat 3. I'll go into detail about this later, but for now, just know that Mortal Kombat 3 is the game I played for research and the game I will be comparing the film to. So, without further ado, let's talk about how Mortal Kombat 3 made the sloppy transition from pixels to pictures. Round 1, characters. So let's just get this out of the way. The acting in this movie is bad, but I don't think this is necessarily the fault of the actors. For one thing, the dialogue in this movie gives the actors very little to work with. For another, I doubt the direction was very good. And for another, I imagine that all of the actors eventually figured out just how corny this movie was going to be and just figured that they didn't need to bring their A material. Let's start with Robin Shao, who is one of two remaining cast members from the first film, as Liu Kang. And yes, I mispronounced the name in the last video, that's my bad. I can't really tell if his acting has improved in this film, or if he just looks better because the quality of acting from the rest of the cast has gone down. The character is mostly the same as he was in the first film, which is fitting, as the character hasn't changed much in the game. The writers attempt to give Liu Kang a dramatic arc, I guess, to believe in himself more or find his animality. It isn't very clear. They at least still mention the guilt he feels over his brother's death and Kitana's kidnapping. I find it a little bit weird that he doesn't seem that upset about Johnny's death at the beginning of the movie. Kind of weird how Sonya is the only one who's affected by that. Oh, by the way, Johnny Cage dies in the opening scene, which I'm sure was upsetting for a lot of people, but not me. He was kind of annoying. Kitana takes over the damsel in distress role from Sonya and gets a few what I guess are supposed to be emotional scenes with her absurdly youthful mother, which were impossible to take seriously. As for Sonya, she's at least more confident than she was in the first film, but her main role seems to be to guide Jax around. As for Jax himself, I guess he had a small role in the first film that was amped up for this one, and he's the supposed comedic relief of the film, which is ironic since I find almost every aspect of the film more humorous than this performance. I'll give him credit that he at least resembles his game counterpart, but I don't think that said game counterpart was as comedic. Now, where the film could have gotten interesting is in the reveal about Raiden's backstory, having him be Shao Kahn's brother. It was not in the game, but as someone with a limited understanding of the franchise, I think it could have been an interesting way to ground this character that is otherwise very mysterious. Had the film put more emphasis on Raiden, perhaps as the protagonist even, we might have gotten a better film. But instead, that plotline is bungled for reasons that I'll cover later. And as for Shao Kahn, I'll give him this, the guy is having fun, which is apparently par for the course with actors playing villains in video game movies. One of the biggest, well, maybe not the biggest, but one of the problems with the film is just how overcrowded it is. It feels like the director was trying to squeeze as many characters from the franchise into the movie as possible, regardless of what their role was. Sometimes it almost works. The fight between Scorpion and Sub-Zero, for example, was nice to see for fans of the game, but it didn't make a whole lot of sense because both of these characters supposedly died in the previous film. If I were tasked with fixing this film, one of my first suggestions would be to increase the runtime. The film is only 93 minutes long, counting credits, and you can't squeeze this many characters into one film and expect us to feel anything about them. So many characters were thrown in out of the blue, and even though many of them do a decent job of looking like their game counterparts, many of them don't act like it. I mean, congrats on trying to fit all these characters in, it didn't really work, but you did try, right? I give it a 3 on the scale. Round 2, setting. Now, I'll start by saying something positive. A lot of the sets and costumes in this movie look like something you might have seen in the game. But that's maybe not saying a great deal considering the fact that most of those were just holdovers from the last movie, so a lot of the work was already done for them. At least the new costumes that were used for additional characters do resemble the ones from the game. As for the sets, well, a lot of the film takes place in Outworld, and I feel at least there was some attempt to match the design of the game. I don't think the production designer did a ton of research, but I bet they were given a few screenshots from the game and told, just make it generally look like that. Hey, it's better than some movies I've looked at in this series. One of the most interesting ideas from the game was the notion that Outworld was bleeding into the normal world, including some of the architecture, and this is something we really don't get to see in the movie beyond a really fake-looking sky. The game also had a lot of stages that took place in surprisingly urban locations, including a highway, a subway, and a church. I imagine the idea behind this was to make the threat of the antagonist feel closer to home, but nothing about the film's environment feels even close to the real world. And where it really all falls apart is in the presentation. This movie had a budget of $30 million, but Lord knows what that money was actually spent on. Look, the Mortal Kombat universe isn't exactly the most gritty and realistic, but... okay, so these sets. Maybe you can say these sets are passable, but... my god, look at these effects. Keep in mind, this movie came out in the year 1997, the same year that Titanic came out, and 4 years after Jurassic Park. Maybe it's not fair to compare this movie to the best of the best, but there were so many movies that came out this decade, and several decades before that, that look better than this film. Go watch an effects movie from the 1950s. Even if you can tell how the effect was done, there's still a lot of creativity and effort that went into it. But this... I mean... I can do effects that look like this. Actually, come to think of it, I have done effects that look like this, and I did it with significantly less than $30 million. So, while there is at least some effort to try and make the characters and environment look like something from the Mortal Kombat universe, there is no excuse for a live-action film adaptation of a 16-bit video game to actually look worse than the game. It gets a 4. Round 3, story. As I said in the beginning, the story of this film is an adaptation of the third game in the series rather than the second. My best guess for why they decided to do this was to make the story of the film feel as big as possible. Okay, so recap. The first Mortal Kombat game was about a tournament between humans, where the champion would face Shang Tsung in a battle where the world would be at stake. Long story short, good guys win, Shang Tsung loses. In the second game, Shang Tsung's boss, Shao Kahn, lures the heroes to Outworld for a rematch. Yada yada yada, good guys win. Third game, Shao Kahn decides enough is enough, and that he's going to invade Earth without the tournament, and the heroes have to defend their realm. Plot-wise, it's a pretty solid trilogy. But the filmmakers decided to remove the second story to get to the grand finale as soon as possible, and jumping straight from the first story to the third story created a pretty big problem. At the beginning of the film, Shao Kahn's armies arrive on Earth. Liu Kang says, "I thought our victory is closed to those portals," and then Raiden, with zero emotion on his face, says, "What closes can also be opened again." So, basically, literally everything that the heroes accomplished in the first movie was all for nothing, and Raiden doesn't even seem that upset by it. Wow. A good sequel is supposed to build on the foundation of what came before, but this movie seems determined to undo the work of the first film. I mean, Johnny Cage, one of the main characters of the first film, dies in the opening scene, and after that, they show how his death affects Sonya, but not Liu Kang or Raiden, who were supposedly friends with him. Why didn't they have bigger reactions to his death? Maybe because the film didn't have the time for it, which leads me to the next giant problem. And I've covered this before, but this is where it really is important. This movie is trying to tell an epic story that involves dozens of characters and a huge scope, where the fate of the very world is at stake. And it's trying to tell that story in 93 minutes, counting credits. I don't know why the filmmakers felt they had to rush so much, but the end result is a movie that doesn't give the audience any time to breathe. Most of this movie is just non-stop fight sequences that occasionally get interrupted by dialogue scenes in which the characters try to dish out as much exposition as they can before the next fight starts. They do make attempts here and there to have emotional beats in the narrative, and it simply doesn't work. The plot is so fast-paced that it's impossible to connect with any of the characters. But to be fair, maybe the film's real problem isn't the story itself, but the terrible production value. When I was first writing this video, I was planning on giving a slightly higher score to the movie in this round. It's certainly not a boring film, and it does, to its credit, follow the loose plot of the game it's adapting. But the more I thought about it, the more I realized that if the film had better production value, the story would really stand out as being terrible. It gets points for being faithful, but it loses points for being bad. I give it a 3. And final round, experience. Like the first film, this movie does have a lot of fighting scenes, and it does pull at least some inspiration from the game. If you look closely, there are glimmers of competency that can just barely be seen. The best examples are the fight between Scorpion and Sub-Zero, and the final showdown between Liu Kang and Shao Kahn, where they reprise the incredible theme song from the first film. I'll admit, it's hard to hear that song and not get pumped up. But most of the fight sequences are done poorly. There's an overabundance of wirework and effects, and the editing and cinematography makes some of the action scenes difficult to follow. It's weird because the director of this film did the cinematography for the first one, and he did a good job. So now that he's moved into the director's chair, you'd think he would at least understand the importance of hiring a good cinematographer. Technically speaking, the amount of fighting in the film is consistent with the game, but part of adapting something into a different medium is making the changes that need to be made. In a movie, you have to have more than just fighting. You have to have characters that are worth caring about and a story that is worth getting invested in. But it is impossible to take anything in this film seriously because of the sheer lack of competency that is on full display. Look, I'll be frank with you. I'm not really a Mortal Kombat fan. I play the games for research purposes, but they're not really my thing. However, it's clear that a lot of people are huge fans of this franchise, and even I can tell that they deserve better than this. So, As a recent graduate from Nashville Film Institute and aspiring filmmaker, how would I fix this movie? First, I would extend the runtime by about 20 minutes or so. Then I would hire a talented editor and talented cinematographer. Then I would have a lengthy chat with the special effects department and figure out how to best take advantage of our budget. If there's an effect that we can't do very well, does that effect really need to be in the movie? And then I'd work on the script a bit. Have Raiden be really upset that Shao Kahn has disrespected the rules of the tournament. Have him and the others in a state of shock after Johnny Cage's death. Have them decide that everything they did before will not be in vain. Have the characters push themselves farther and farther. Have them get emotional. Have them yell. Have them cry. Have them get knocked down but always keep getting back up. And then let the Elder Gods realize that the ability to keep fighting even when everything seems hopeless is what makes humanity strong and worth saving. There, that's a good start. And you can still have the fighting scenes as the main focus. We don't need to make this movie an Oscar-worthy film, just a solidly made action movie that has something to say, however cliche that might be. The film, as it stands today, disrespects the audience. The experience of watching the movie is not even close to the experience of playing the game, and gamers do deserve better than this. But with all that being said, if you're the kind of person who enjoys watching bad movies to laugh at them, I highly recommend Mortal Kombat Annihilation. With the right mindset, this movie is absolutely hilarious. It is the very definition of so bad it's good. But if you were a Mortal Kombat fan who saw this movie in the theaters, I suspect it wasn't as funny to you. It gets a 1. So, when all is said and done, Mortal Kombat Annihilation gets 11 out of 40, 27% for the final score of F. Absolutely no surprise there. But I did rank it 1 point higher than Super Mario Bros. At the end of the day, this film is more faithful to the game it's adapting than Super Mario Bros. I'm curious if any film can go below that ranking. Next time, I'll be looking at one of the lesser-known video game movies, Wing Commander, a film directed by the same person who created the game. I'm really curious to see how that turned out. In the meantime, stay safe, everyone, and I will see you later.